function. Additionally, guys, databases, at least most of the modern databases that are available to us, are actually queried using a language called SQL. And we'll be looking at SQL in a little bit more detail for now, in a few moments, but it's great to know that once you learn the SQL language, you don't have to just use MySQL or MariaDB. You can use all of the databases softwares that are out there in the world that react to SQL. We'll finish things off then, guys, with an actual demonstration. What we'll do is we'll build a database, and then we'll actually add information to it using the PHP programming language. Before we go into actual content of today's class, guys, I just want to do a quick review of what we know about PHP and also what we know about databases. First things first, guys, PHP is a back-end coding language. That means that it exists and it also executes on the web server. So that means that it'll never be seen in a user's browser, which is brilliant for security reasons and also for other reasons as well, for speed and for efficiency. Finally, guys, they get written between these PHP pseudo tags. So what we can do is rename a HTML file to a PHP file, and then we can begin to add these PHP tags into which we write the PHP itself. The PHP module on our server stack will scan any PHP files and then execute the PHP code on the server before it ever gets sent out to the user's browser. Of course, guys, as I've mentioned, PHP's main function really is to write out HTML and also to interact with databases, which is the topic of today's class. However, we've actually know a little bit about them already. All the way back in lesson one, we learned a little bit about how databases work and where they sit. So a quick review, guys, of some of the things that we already know. First things first, they lie behind most of the information systems that we actually already use today. So that could be the phone book on your mobile phone. It could be Facebook's giant database of all the comments made by every user ever. It could be the login details so that you can access your account on any given website. All of that kinds of things. So, guys, this does extend to just about every web application out there. Anything that needs to be able to sort of react and remember information will generally use a database to hold that data. The reason for that is because it is able to organize that information very efficiently. And that means that it can be very easily accessed, managed, and updated. By keeping the information organized, well, that means that we'll know exactly where to go when we want a specific piece of information. Additionally, guys, databases are designed to be easily talked to by other back-end programming languages, so we can use any back-end language and we'll be able to converse with a database. Okay, so databases, of course, sit on the web server itself, just like the back-end coding language. And that basically is the entirety of the back-end. It's the software, it is the database, and it is the back-end code. Okay. So, guys, you've seen this already, and this is probably the final time I'll actually have to show you this, because now you actually know about every single piece that's inside this graph that I'm going to show you. So what actually happens? Where does the database fit? Well, the user will make a request to the internet for a particular website. The internet will find the web server on which that website is located. And then the web server will start to do its tasks. So this is everything that the web developer would actually be concerned with. Apache will load up its file system, and then the PHP module will actually be scanning all of the files on the system. It'll be creating any interactions with the database that it needs to make, and then after it's done all of its processing, it will send that information back to the server software, and all that happens, guys, is that we can send out pure HTML back to the user's browser. So, guys, we now know where the database sits in, so let's learn now how we can actually create databases and use them. Okay, guys, so let's get into our overview of databases and today's actual class. So, first things first, let's define a database. A database, guys, is a structured set of data, and it's held in a computer, and especially one that is accessible in many ways. So, first of all, it's a structured set of data, which means, of course, that it can be easily organized and easily searched through for important information. Now, it's also accessible in various ways. As you guys probably know, web servers exist to serve web pages to anyone who requests it on the internet. So databases need to be accessible from many requests and also as often as possible in a short space of time. Now, before I get into the actual meat, guys, just have a quick question for you, worth bearing in mind for this section. I will, of course, be answering it at the end of the section, as always. So my question to you is, how many records can you have in a standard MySQL database? Okay, so the simplest kind of database, guys, and the one that we will be dealing with, is called a flat file database because they contain simple 2D tables, just like what you would find in an Excel spreadsheet. So if you can imagine a single table inside a database, it looks just like an Excel spreadsheet inside your head. So, specifically to do with databases though, every column in that database table will represent what's known as a field, and each row in that table will represent what's known as a record. So we have a fixed number of fields in general for a given table. So for this table, for example, I have the first name, the surname, and the age of a given person in my table. And then I can add as many records as I want to this table. I can add John Holmes, I can add Ben Franklin. All of that can be added as a record. Now, as aspiring web developers, guys, you will be talking to people who will use the word column and the word field synonymously, as in they will consider them to be the same thing. So it is important, guys, to note that if someone talks about a field or a column in a database, you know that it means the same thing. And the same thing applies, guys, for rows and records. Alright, let's just take a look at a slightly more in-depth example. This is another database table, except this time, guys, it has three columns and two rows. Let's take a look at a single one of these. So there are three pieces of data inside this particular database table. We've got the name, the age, and the address for a given person. And each of these three go into the appropriate field, namely the name, the age, and the address fields for that database table. Okay, so it's all well and good, guys, to have a database, but what can you actually do with one yourselves? Well, we can do things ourselves, like creating user-added content. So basically, guys, what this means is that we can get the users of our website to provide the content for us. We'll store that information on our database, and then when another user is looking for content, we can actually give that content back out to the user. Things like blogs and comments and all of that kind of stuff would fit into this category, like some of the biggest tech companies out there. Something else as well, guys, you can add login functionality to a web application. It's all well and good, guys, having people on your website, but what if you want them to have special login functionality where they can access their personal settings, their accounts, they can make orders, or all of that kind of stuff? Well, you'll need to be able to store their login information somewhere, and a database is a perfect place to do that. You can store their username and their password, and what happens, guys, is because the computer actually automatically verifies that the login is correct, at no point does a human need to see a password. And if you get into this security side of web development, you'll learn very quickly that it's very important, guys, to protect that information. So we don't want humans to see that information, but a database is perfect because it'll perfectly be able to automatically verify that information. Finally, guys, we can let a web server create your HTML pages for you. So between your PHP and database, and this kind of follows on from user-added content, we can actually create a web page out of nowhere. And we will actually be doing that, guys, in our last lesson, in lesson 8, in just a couple of days. Okay, so there have been a few questions asked about this, so let me just answer this real quick now, because it is actually a good question to ask, and I'd like to answer it as completely as possible. A lot of people have been asking what the difference is between MariaDB and MySQL, and why are we using MariaDB? Well, guys, the answer is that MariaDB and MySQL are about as similar as Google Chrome is to Mozilla Firefox. They're just two different groups of people who've built the same functionality, but with their own ideas as to what the best way to build it is. So it's just different softwares that serve the same purpose. In fact, it goes a little deeper than that for MariaDB, because MariaDB's current developers are the former developers of MySQL. Now, MariaDB is still free and open source, whereas MySQL is now owned by an actual corporation, so it's a little bit different, guys. But it is important to note that companies like Google and Wikipedia, Tumblr, Twitter and WordPress, they're all moving to MariaDB. So this generally would suggest to you guys that MariaDB is a good software package to be using if you want to create a database. Additionally, guys, it's also completely free to use. It's very easy to set up. All you have to do is install XAMPP and you already have it. And finally, guys, it's pretty easy to use, which we'll be showing you in the next section. Alright, so let's go back to this question I asked, guys. How many records can you have in a standard MySQL database? We got a bunch of answers earlier on. It says the answer is a really, really large number. For those of you guys who are mathematically inclined, 2 to the power of 32 records is the number of records you can store in a standard database, or even 2 to the power of 64 if you're using a special table designed to hold even more records. Just to put that into perspective, guys, that is 4.3 billion records for a regular standard table, or even 18 quintillion records if you're talking about the special large size table. Now, going back to the point there earlier on about the hard drives, you're right is that MySQL database can only hold as many records as it has space. So if you don't have a large enough hard drive on your computer, that would be a problem. But in general, guys, it's actually just even more often limited by something called a primary key. Primary keys are something that we will be studying in the advanced course, but for now, guys, all you need to know is that they are a way of uniquely identifying a record. Generally, most developers will use like an integer or something like that to store that, and thanks to computer science, integers only have can go up to a couple of 100,000, so, I don't know, about 65,000, I believe. So that is more often the limiting factor. You do have to design your site, guys, to be as efficient as possible. And if you're planning on having a large number of records, well, your primary key will probably have to be more than a standard integer. Alright, guys, so let's move into our next section. So we're going to be talking now about the SQL programming language. Now, SQL, guys, stands for Structured Query Language. You'll also hear the phrases SQL, SQL. Any of those, guys, they all mean the SQL language. So Structured Query Language, guys, it is the language that's used to communicate with a relational databases. As I've mentioned, the vast majority of relational databases use SQL. So if you've learned how to use SQL properly, you probably will be able to interact with the vast majority of databases that are out there and available in the world. Alright, quick question, guys, before we move into the next section. Which keywords in SQL is used to pull field data from a database table? Now, I know, as always, that some of you guys will already have the answer to this question, but we will come back to this at the end, and hopefully you'll know the answer by then. We got a couple of people saying some information already, which is absolutely fine, but of course, we'll be covering it, guys, in the following section. Okay, so how do we actually use SQL? What do we do with SQL to make it work? Well, guys, when you're trying to write an SQL string and get the database to execute the SQL string, first of all, you just write it down and you store it in whatever backend language you're using as your backend language. So in our case, we'd be writing a string inside PHP. Once we've prepared this SQL string, we actually just send it to the database management system using our backend coding language. At this point, guys, the database will read the SQL string, it will complete the instructions, and then all it'll do is tell us whether or not it was successfully able to complete instructions. Important to note, guys, that if a failure to execute instructions occurs, generally, you've probably written something wrong with your SQL string. There are other reasons why something like that would happen, but generally, guys, you would have to correct your SQL string to make sure that it's not broken. Now, how do we actually send to the database management system? Well, PHP, fortunately for us, has a very neat MySQLi object. Now, we haven't covered objects in detail yet, although we will be in the advanced course. But for now, guys, you basically, all you need to know is that the MySQLi object basically contains all of the functions and all of the variables that we're going to need to interact with the database. So all we're going to be doing is using this MySQLi object, and all of the hard work will be done for us. Excuse me. And okay, so that's all good, and then we have our SQL string. But how do we actually write an SQL string? Well, let's have a look at some of the more basic SQL instructions that we'll be using in this introduction course. We will be using two in this course, guys, and one of these we will be using today. So the first thing I want to look at is the select SQL string that I have written up here. So I'm just going to break this down and go through it one step at a time, guys. We have got the word, I'm trying to get my pen out here. Let's undo that for a sec. We've got the select keyword, guys. So all keywords in SQL are recognized by the database as specific instructions. Select is, of course, a very important one because it tells the database that we want to pull information from the table. So, what about the next thing? We've got an asterisk as well. This asterisk, does anyone actually know what this asterisk means? Because some of you guys may never have seen an asterisk in this context before. Okay, so we got a few people coming in, guys. Select all the information, select everything, select all fields, select all of the fields. yes, absolutely correct, guys. Basically, we want all of the fields from the table. So that means whatever number of fields there are in this table, I want all of the information from it. So asterisk, guys, in SQL means everything. Okay, so following the asterisk, guys, is the from keyword. So the from keyword is another keyword that just says, I want it to come from this particular table. And that's it. It's just that table, so I want all the information from this table, and that's it. Of course, this is just a placeholder name. You put the name of your actual table in there in a real-life scenario. Okay, so what's next? We have our insert statement, and this is the statement that we'll actually be using today. So let's go through this again with our pen, and we'll see what we can do from here. Here we go. All right. So first things first, guys, we want to insert information. So these are two of the big commands that you can do in SQL. You can select information from, and you can insert information into. So logically, guys, we need to let it know then where the table is coming from. So into is sort of similar to from, except that it applies specifically to the insert keyword. It says, I want to tell you the name of the table that I'm putting the information into. So then you can name your table, and then optionally, guys, you can also add the names of the fields in brackets afterwards, because there is going to be an occasion where you only want to add specific fields, you only want to fill specific fields, or alternatively, you also want to insert the fields in a specific order. And then finally, guys, we let it know the values, and then we can put all the values that we want separated by commas in circular brackets. It looks a little bit like an array in PHP, although of course it's not, but that's it, guys. We can just insert all the values we want. So value 1 will be compared with the field 1, and then we've got value 2 will be field 2, and then value 3 will be field 3. Alright, so that covers, guys, the basic SQL instructions, and that's absolutely brilliant, but let's put this information into practice now. We're actually going to build a database, and we're actually going to insert information to it using PHP and the MySQLi object. So, one second, guys, I'm just going to open up my Notepad++ as usual, and here we go. Close these, and we've got a new document here that we can actually just write out. Now, at this point, guys, you've all seen this before, so I'm just going to build the raw HTML using a template that I have here. So this is our doctype declaration, the HTML, the head, and the body, and then our title, as always, guys. So the title will be the HTML form. And that's what all this page is going to do eventually. Of course, I want this to be accessible from the server, so I'm going to have to create a new folder here. This folder is going to be called December 7, because this is, of course, Lesson 7, and it's December. Oh, sorry, guys. I actually saved the name of the file as that, so let me just go ahead and undo that real quick. And we're going to create a new folder called December 7. Then we're just going to save this file as an index.html file because, guys, we're actually not building a PHP file here. This is going to be a pure HTML file that's going to send information to our database. Before we go any further, though, guys, let's go ahead and build our actual database. You guys will remember from our PHP lesson that we need to have XAMPP running in order to access our server through the browser. So I'm going to actually start Apache, and I'm also going to start the MySQL module. If you want to be able to access your database, you need to activate both of these modules. Okay, so I have both of those working now, guys, and now I can open up my web browser, and I can just access localhost. I can type localhost, and it'll bring me to the XAMPP dashboard. As you can see, this is the introduction page, which you've seen all the way back in Lesson 4. But what we're interested in today, guys, is the PHP MyAdmin interface. PHP MyAdmin is a really useful user interface to make interacting with MySQL and MariaDB databases really easy. So all we have to do, guys, is use this to create and manage our databases, and we can still insert information and pull information from our database using something like PHP. Okay, guys, so in order to create a database, what I actually have to do is click this new button. As you can see, I have a bunch of databases here already, but they're not really going to serve our purposes today. We're going to create a brand new database for today's class. So I'm going to click on the new button here. Now, as you can see, it'll ask me to enter the name of my database and then to give it something called a collation. So first things first, I'm just going to name it the DecemberDB. I'm just going to call it December. And then the collation, guys. Now, this is something that's sort of outside the scope of this course. Collation basically means what character set is used by the database. Now, for the most part, guys, the vast majority of you guys will be perfectly fine with UTF-8 Unicode CI or UTF-8 General CI. But guys, if you are if you write in a language that doesn't use standard letters, like not the alphabet, or if you use Chinese characters, for example, or if you write in Arabic, you will have to do a quick check on the internet, guys, to make sure that UTF-8 Unicode CI works for you. But guys, if you're writing in the alphabet, you should be perfectly fine with this, and that'll be great. In fact, I think Arabic is actually covered as well. I'm not sure about some of the other languages. So I just selected my correct collation and I clicked on the create button, and that was it, guys. I've created my database. But I'm not done yet. It's all well and good having a database, but you can't do anything unless we have a table inside the database. So we're going to create a table now. And for today's lesson, guys, I'm just going to create a basic movie table, and we're going to learn how to add information to this movie table. This movie table is going to have three columns. I mentioned a primary key before, but we don't need to worry about that for today. At today's lesson, we're just going to have three columns in our movie table: the title of the movie, the genre of the movie, and then the rating of the movie, and then we'll be good to go from there. So I'm going to click on the go button here, and as you can see, guys, it's been perfectly fine and able to create the table, and all I need to do is tell it what the names and suggest information for those fields, and that's the last step to creating the table. Now, I'm going to be talking about the name, the type, and the length sections here today. The rest of it, we don't need to worry about it until the advanced course. But for now, guys, let's just go ahead and give a name to each of our three fields. So as I said, we're going to have title, genre, and we're also going to have rating. That's easy enough. You can name a field basically anything you like. It is important, though, that it makes some sort of sense, especially if you're working with other developers. So the second field, guys, is the type field. So this is the database's equivalent of data types inside both PHP and JavaScript. As you can see, the default is int, which stands for integer, which is any whole number. Of course, that's not what we actually want today. What we actually want is what's known as a varchar. A varchar is kind of like a string in PHP and JavaScript. It'll allow us to have symbols, letters, and numbers, and they can all go into the field. So to keep things simple, guys, for today's lesson, everything is just going to be a varchar, because all of the information in these three fields will need to be a varchar. The final thing, guys, is the length of each of these fields. This is the amount of actual hard drive space that's allocated to each of these three fields for every single record that's added to the table. So for the purposes of this class, it doesn't really matter, but we're just going to say that each of these has 50 characters worth of space. I will, though, be showing you at the end of the class what happens if you go over the limit, because it does actually have a very important impact on web development in general. Okay, so now I'm actually done setting up a basic set. Oops, sorry guys. Now I'm set up having with my basic set of fields, and all I have to do now is click on the save button, and here we go. We have a movie table with three fields. Each of them have a type of varchar with 50 characters allocated to each record, and we're good to go from the perspective of a table. Now we have a database sitting there on the server waiting to receive requests for information or receive requests to add information to itself. So now all that remains to be done, guys, is for us to actually build the website that's going to allow us to add information to this database. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a form, form.html. So you guys have already seen me create a form at the end of the PHP lesson 6 last week, but we're going to go ahead and do it again. So we're going to create a form. Now, just a quick question for you guys. Does anyone remember what the name of the HTML element that needs to go into the form field is? We need the input field for a form. So this allows the user of our website to actually add data to the website, after which we can go ahead and send it off to the server. So we've got our inputs. We're going to have three inputs, guys. We're going to have an input for the title, we're going to have an input for the genre, and we're going to also have an input for the rating. And the last thing then, guys, is we're going to need a button which is going to submit the information to the actual server. Okay, one second while I type things out here, guys. All right. So, guys, you'll remember from the last lesson, probably, that we can give these inputs a type attribute. This lets the web browser know what kind of information to expect in the input field. Of course, these will all just be text for the title, genre, and rating of a movie. And then finally, guys, for the button, we're actually going to need something different. We're going to need it to be of type submit, so that the browser knows that when this button is clicked, it needs to send the form to the other table. Alright, so that's good. We're making some progress on this form, guys. We need a couple more pieces of information. First of all, you'll remember from the end of Lesson 6 that we also need to give these inputs a name so that they can actually be referenced once they get sent to the other page. So you can give any input a name, guys, and it will simply be referenceable from the other page. So I'm going to give this a name of title, a name of genre, and a name of rating. So these will be our three input fields here. I'm actually going to save this now, guys, and I'm going to load it up in my server, and we're going to have a look to see if it's doing everything that it's supposed to. We're going to go to that's not the right place. We're going to December 7. And, of course, because it's the index file, it's the default go-to location if no file is specified. Okay, so I now have my three inputs here, and I have my submit button. It's a very basic web page, but it'll do for the purposes of today's task. Now, just a quick note, guys, I may accidentally type the wrong information into these fields, so it is important that you do what's known as labeling your form. So that's going to require us to add some additional information, which I'm going to quickly put in here. So the label is a special HTML attribute, guys, that simply labels any input that it's connected to. So, for example, this label is going to say title, and it's going to be in reference to this title here. Additionally, guys, to connect this label to this input, we need to add what's known as a for attribute. This for attribute will actually be equal to the ID of the field that it's connected to. So if I go ahead and give this an ID of title, well, now suddenly, guys, this label is connected to this input. So this label, because it's a for attribute, is the same as the ID, it's now connected. If I actually save this, guys, and refresh the page, you'll notice that the title has appeared, just like if it was just a standard paragraph. However, if I actually click on the word title, it'll select the input box to which it's connected. So this is just to show you guys that these two HTML elements are actually connected together using the for and the ID attributes. Alright, so I'm going to do the same thing, guys, for the genre and the rating. Of course, the only difference being that it's going to be for the genre, and it's going to say genre, and it's going to be for the rating, and it's going to say rating. And then finally, guys, I need to have IDs for the inputs to which they're connected. So I'm going to add an ID here. And that shouldn't say rating, that should say genre. So guys, this label's for this input, and this label is for this input. We need to add some attributes to this form, because this form doesn't know two things. It doesn't know where to send the information to. It also doesn't know how to send the information. So we need to use the action attribute, and we also need to use the method attribute. As I've mentioned, the method is always going to be equal to post, guys, because we're always going to be sending the information. In the advanced course, we'll be learning about things like the get method, but for now, we don't need to worry about it. For now, everything we're doing is sending information. Finally, guys, we're going to need to name the file that is supposed to receive this information. We haven't actually created it yet, but we are going to very soon, and we're going to call it the insert.php file. So what I'm going to do now, guys, is save this, refresh this to make sure it's working, which it still is, and then I'm going to create a new file, which I'm going to save as a PHP file. So I'm just going to write my PHP tags here, and I'm going to save this file, guys, as insert.php. So now, that index.html file will actually send all of this information to the insert.php file. And as we might remember from Lesson 6, you can actually access that information with the $_post array. This is a special super global array that has all of the information that it has received via the post method. So, what information do we have we received in this document? Well, we've received a title, a genre, and a rating, and we can simply reference that information by going $_post title, $_post genre, and $_post rating. So this is the three pieces of information that this file is going to have to work with. This is information that will have been submitted by the user of that web page. There's a lot more involved, though, because we have to send all the information, all of that cool stuff. But, guys, we're running a little bit low on time. So what I'm actually going to do is copy-paste the file, and I'm actually going to explain it as I go along. So first things first, guys, I'm going to copy the file, and then I'll let you know exactly what's involved in the file. As you can see, guys, it's about 30 lines of code, but a lot of that is actually comments to help explain what's going on to you guys. So I'm going to go over it one line at a time, and hopefully by the end, you'll understand exactly what's going on. We'll start, guys, with this first section at the top. I'm just going to move the rest down for a bit. So, guys, this is our database information. We're going to need the database information in order to access our database. So, we need to know where it's located. It's located in localhost, because in our case, we're using XAMPP, so everything is local on our computer. It also requires the username and password to access the database, guys. In our case, we're using the default root with no password. Now, if this was a live server, this would be very dangerous, but this is just a development testing server, so we can leave it at the defaults for now. But guys, you should never ever have that as your username and password if you're going to have a live website. Finally, guys, we need to name the database that we're trying to access. In our case, I believe we called it the December database. So we're going to go ahead and save it as the December database. So it's all well and good having all that information and storing it in a variable, but what are we actually going to do with that information? Well, guys, we're going to create a connection to the database through the MySQLi object. Now, again, we haven't studied objects yet, but it's a lot similar to what you've seen before. We've got the connection variable is being equal to, this is a object thing, but then we're just calling this MySQLi function. It's a function, guys, and it has four arguments. It's asking us for all of this information, so we're just putting it in one at a time, and then it can establish a connection to the database for us. All of that connection information, guys, is stored in another object called the connection. So we're going to be able to use that connection to send information, receive information, whatever it is that we like to do. In fact, we use it immediately afterwards by checking if there was an error to the connection. If there was one, guys, we immediately stop the script using the die function. That means that everything below this line of code will not get executed. This is a security measure, guys, and it's also a good idea to do. You don't need to execute code if there was a failed connection, because everything we're doing relies on that connection. So if that connection's gone, there's no point in doing anything else. Again, guys, this is object-oriented programming, but you will have this code uploaded to your resources area, so you will be able to copy-paste this code. It'll work just the same. It's the way this page was designed. Okay, so the next thing that we need to do, guys, is actually use the information that this page has received. So we're going to go ahead and create our title, genre, and rating variables, and we're going to set them equal to the following three values. That's absolutely fine, guys, and we've now stored this information and we're ready to use it. That's absolutely great. So what's the next thing that we need to do? Well, we need to create our SQL string. I'm actually going to delete this and write this again from scratch, just so that I can show you the mental process of designing an SQL string. So the first thing that I want to know is what I want to actually do with my database. Well, I already know, guys. I want to insert information into my database. Specifically, guys, I want to insert information into a table. So I'm going to insert it into the movie table, which is the name of the table inside that database. Now, I also have the option to, in circular brackets, state the fields in the order that I want to insert the information into it. So I can go ahead and say, in single quotation marks like this, I can go title, and then comma separate genre, and then comma separate rating. So these are the three field names of the information inside my table. Now the next thing I want to do is insert some values, but guys, I want to keep things nice and neat, so I'm actually just going to move that onto a new line. It won't make a difference, guys, because white space is not taken into account inside an SQL string. So we've got, well, it is, but not a new line character or tabs. So we've got the values, guys. What values are we inserting? Well, we're simply inserting all the information that we already cached earlier inside these variables. So we're going to go ahead and say quotation marks title, quotation marks genre, and then we're going to go quotation marks rating. So these will actually put the three variables above into these values, and then we're ready to send our information to our database. Now note, guys, that I'm using a different method to actually do what's known as string concatenation to what you've seen before. PHP has some nice functionality to automatically replace variable names with the appropriate content, so we're just making use of it here to make our lives a little bit easier. Finally, guys, we're going to actually send the query to the database. Now, this is sending the query to the database, and as I said, it'll tell us whether it was successful or not. All it'll do is return the value true, or it'll return the value false. In our case, the return value is true. Well, then it'll say, new record created successfully. If for whatever reason it was false, well, then it'll echo out an error, and it'll tell us what error we made. Finally, guys, once we've finished all our tasks, we need to do our final job of the day, which is to close our connection to the database. It's always a good idea to close connections to a database once you're finished using your database. Okay, guys, so that is our insert file created. Now, all that remains is for us to test our form to see if it can actually insert information. So let's go ahead and just have a little bit of fun here, and we're going to see what we can do. So we're going to do avatar. The genre for avatar is a sci-fi, I guess, so it's going to be a sci-fi. And the rating is going to be really blue people. And then we're going to have an exclamation mark. So guys, we now have to submit this information. So let's go ahead and submit this information to the database. And would you believe it, guys? It looks like there's been an error because for some reason, this file hasn't told me if there was a successful record inserted or not. So I have to do some really quick error handling here just to make sure that everything is okay. We got title, genre, rating. Sorry guys, looks like we've made a minor error here, so we're going to have to make sure that the insert file is absolutely correct. We've got, just going to check. Actually, I think this is a mistake. We shouldn't be doing that. Okay. Okay, so let's give that a shot and see if this works. So sorry about that, guys. That looks like it was doing some strange stuff. Alright. So we're going to refresh and try again. We'll try avatar one more time, guys. We're going to say sci-fi, and the rating is really blue people. So let's give this a shot now, guys. Here we go, submit. And there we go, we've got new record created successfully. So what happened before, guys, is that the string, I shouldn't have put the field names inside quotation marks because it actually would have assumed that the field name included a quotation mark, which of course it didn't. So that's the reason why that error occurred. So this says new record created successfully. So let's have a look and see, guys. Did we successfully add information to this database using PHP? Well, I'm going to click on the movie table to... interesting. Oh. What is going on, guys? This is very strange. Okay, so we've got Avatar, Sci-Fi, and Really Blue, but it actually stops going from there. Now, this is really strange because I'm pretty confident that we said that it could have 50 characters. So did we make multiple mistakes today? Well, no, this says 50 characters. I wonder if I just, Oh, sorry, guys. I didn't fill out my rating, so I actually just wrote Really Blue and then submitted that. So my apologies. It looks like it's working perfectly fine. So we've got Hunger Games is another one. So let's go ahead and write the Hunger Games. Genre is, don't know what the genre of Hunger Games is. We'll say it is a Battle Royale. And the rating is, rating is really cool. And we're going to submit this, and we're going to say new record created successfully. All right, so let's add a few more guys, and we'll see what happens here. We've got Ninja Assassin. We got genre, probably a fighting genre, and the rating is I have no idea, and we're going to submit that. We're going to have one more then, and then we're going to be done. Okay, so we've got Interstellar. Genre is, of course, fantasy, and the rating is Black Hole. Okay, so we're going to submit this data, and it'll say new record created successfully. So let's refresh this, guys. I've refreshed this now. I'm going to click on the movies table again. And as you can see, guys, it successfully added new records, and it stored them long-term. How cool is that? If I turned off my computer, guys, and then I come back when, you know, 6 hours from now or 2 days from now, and I open up this file again, it will still have this information stored. So we will be learning in our next class how we can actually use the information that's stored to create a dynamic web page. And I'm hoping you're all excited to see us move to that. Last thing I'm going to do, though, guys, before I go back to the presentation, is to quickly show you what happens if we do a test and we accidentally use too many characters. In a field with a length that is too low. So you can see how long that rating was, guys. I'm going to submit it, and here we go. It actually says that we created a new record successfully. And although that's true, the problem, guys, is that it actually deletes everything after 50 characters. It can't store any more characters. So it's very important to use things like validation and things like that to ensure that this doesn't happen, that we can't submit information unless it's an allowed amount of characters. So you guys can strike the balance between how much space you use on your database versus how much how much validation and all of that kind of stuff, and how much things like that. Alright, guys, we're going to go back to the presentation and we're going to finish things. But before that, I'd like to ask you, which keyword or keywords in SQL is or are used to pull field data from a database table? We need to use the select keyword and the from keyword, and between those two keywords we have our fields and we have our table. So I will actually just leave it go here. Have a good morning, afternoon, evening, wherever you guys are in the world. It was an absolute pleasure.